Hey everybody, it's Brad with the Big Family Homestead, and today we have just a crazy, super special, awesome treat. We are here at the Edgar Steam Show, and I'm here with Andy. He's an expert in all of these cool things, and he's gonna tell us a little bit about some of the stuff we're gonna see today. Okay, the steam engine that is back here. Now, what exactly was this one designed to do?
So this is actually a little different. This is what came right after the steam engine. This is actually a gasoline engine similar to what you would find in your car. As farmers got a little bigger, they actually wanted the tractors to get smaller. Much like our technology today, it always starts out big, then goes a little smaller. We saw with steam engines earlier, they're large machines. They're not very maneuverable. So the farmers demanded something more maneuverable, easy to handle, and that's what we have behind
Attention.
Us. This is a tractor that's designed for plowing, threshing.
As we were so rudely interrupted by the voice, the PA system, now this was designed to do what?
So this is designed for plowing, threshing, silo filling, any basic chores that need to be done on a farm. This particular tractor is capable of pulling about a three-bottom plow. So in comparison to a horse, you get work done more than three times as fast. So it's very revolutionary for a farm that was making that transition from animal power to mechanized power.
That's awesome. So just like today, we're seeing bigger machines getting smaller that do more. Now, a question I have is the cost. Like, is it comparable to what tractors cost today? Like, what would this set a farmer back?
So back in those days, this tractor sold new from the factory for about $1,800. So it was a significant investment for a farm, and oftentimes several farms would go in together to buy a tractor. In the case of this specific tractor, this is a fourth generation owned tractor, so I'm familiar with the family that owns it. Three brothers went together to buy this tractor, a three bottom plow, and then a Fox silo filler, all of a package deal. And then they rotated that from farm to farm throughout the seasons to do their work that they needed.
So this is an interesting build here, but why is the radiator situated the way it is?
So back in these times, tractor companies, there was no design to build a tractor. So every company was trying different things, experimenting with different ideas and concepts. The reason that we placed a radiator like this, or this particular company's logic behind that thought, is to make it more visible for the operator to stand on the platform. So if we walk this way just a little bit, as I'm operating this tractor, I'm standing right up here. And with it standing up here, I got a nice line right down the side of this tractor without a big box sitting in my way. So it's very ergonomic for the farmer. So this tractor is actually a really unique tractor. It has two different fuels. So this tractor, around this time period of 1916 when this tractor was built, kerosene was prevalent due to kerosene lanterns in homes. It was also less than half the price of gasoline. So kerosene is a little bit unique in how it runs an engine. An engine needs to be really warm for that kerosene to burn effectively. So you couldn't just put kerosene in your tractor and start it. You had to warm that engine up. So most tractors, like in the example of this one, would have two fuel tanks on it. So if we look at this tank right here, we see there's two caps. This isn't one large tank. This is actually a tank that's divided up into two. And right here, we have a nice small tank. This is what we would put gasoline in. It's about 2 gallons worth. So what we would do is we would start the tractor on gasoline, let that engine warm up for just a little bit, and then we would switch the fuel over to kerosene, and that's what we would burn primarily. So that way we can save that farmer as much money as possible. Again, it was more accessible and a lot cheaper, so it's what was demanded of them. So a lot of engines in that time period, for whatever reason, were horizontal, such as the case here. So this is a two-cylinder engine. The pistons inside this engine, run side by side from one another. So they just go back and forth together, and then the spark will actually fire every other piston. So it'll start here, next revolution will be over here. So it makes this a really even putt, putt, putt noise as it goes. So it's a really unique sound. Everything is exposed on these tractors. This was before OSHA and before they realized that, hey, dust is going to be a problem for these.
We are going to get caught up into this machine of death that will not stop.
Exactly. So everything is exposed, even the gears. So it was designed for easy access, but actually became more problematic because not only was it a safety issue, but more importantly, it was a dust trap. we'd put oil on all of these mechanisms to keep them lubricated, and dust collects on oil, so it actually turned into kind of like a sandpaper paste, which wore engines out really quickly. So their logic behind it to keep it exposed for easier work with the farmers actually turned to be a bad idea. So as the decades went on, probably within the next 10 years or so, you'll see more and more of these tractor companies going to enclosed compartments, enclosed transmissions, gears, valve covers, everything kind of got buttoned up the way it is what we see today.
A thresher, correct?
Yes, yes. So we're going to take a look at a thresher. Currently, we're working on a thresher which is powered by a steam engine. Threshing is a process of removing grain from the chaff, the straw. So right here, this is wheat. Inside these wheat pods, we have a bunch of seeds. So what this machine is doing is essentially rubbing out these seeds and blowing away the chaff to leave us with our grain. These machines were popular from late 1800s all the way up into the 1940s. They were being used until we started developing the combine. So imagine this machine basically is a stationary combine. Instead of driving through the field to harvest the grain, you pick the grain and brought it to the machine to separate it from the chaff. So if we take a look at this machine right here, this is a turn of the century steam engine. This is actually powered by steam. This bottom black portion is a boiler. Inside that, there's a large fire, which is boiling water to produce steam power. That, in return, powers a piston, which powers our drive belt to the machine.
So now, in terms of actual working hours, people that this kind of machine actually replaced and saved time, what kind of time savings are we talking about?
The time savings is really exponential. So the process of removing grain 100, 200 years ago was lay it on the ground, flog it, step on it with animals, trample it to remove this gradually. So for instance, this wagon behind me, that represents a few acres of grain. That would have taken days, probably a week, to separate that grain. With this machine and this equipment, we can get that done in about 20, 30 minutes at most. So the time saving and this labor savings is just exponential.
Wow.
All right, so taking a look inside this machine, we have one of the panels open. You see lots of shaking, and there's actually a lot of air being blown through that machine. The process that follows is, as these seeds are coming out of these pods, the seeds are very dense, they're very heavy, and they don't catch a lot of wind. So they fall to the very bottom of the machine. But as those platforms shake, it moves this straw towards the back of the machine, the seeds fall, and there's also wind blowing, so that gets thrown out this chute right up here. This is where all the trash is gonna come blowing out, and the seeds will collect at the bottom, and then an auger will take them out into a grain wagon. All right, so now we're taking a look at a steam engine. This is a turn of the century steam engine built in 1921. This was the main power right around the late 1800s to the 1920s, we'll say, is when steam started being phased out. How a steam engine basically works is in this rear, near the rear wheel, we have a firebox. So it's basically a big metal box completely surrounded by water. And from that firebox is a series of tubes that go towards the front of this barrel. That carries the smoke out of the fire and up the stack. So all this metal component is completely surrounded by water. So as this fire heats this metal, it then begins to boil. That steam is collected at the very top of the engine in what's called the steam dome. And from there, it's pumped into the engine. And so it's basically a piston, and we pump steam on each side of that piston to get it to move back and forth. That then turns into rotary motion, and we're able to power our equipment.
All right, you have been an incredible wealth of information, inspiration, and even perspiration. So you actually have your own YouTube channel, is that correct?
Yeah, so I just started experimenting with a little bit of drone footage to sort of capture these amazing machines in action from a perspective or a point of view that most people can't really take advantage of. So if you go on YouTube and YouTube tractor drone, all one word, you can see some of these interesting machines in action with a little different perspective.
So folks, go ahead, open up a new window right now, go on over to
YouTube, Tractor Drone, or subscribe to Andy Morvick, AndyMorAVEC, all one word, and subscribe to my page, I'd really appreciate it. I hope you guys enjoy.
Tractor Drone. Anyway, I'm Brad.
I'm Krista.
And you guys have an amazing day. Remember them? trouble now.
So here's that's lemongrass.
There's a lavender mark.
Oh yeah.
All right, we found something a little more up your speed. What do you think?
Needs to be red.
Needs to be red.
One of these,
and we don't even have a homestead house here.
No,
we're kicking it old school.
That's right.